what we'll cover, basically our talk will be a like of kind of whatever in the parsing, whatever we have done, what is to be done, and look around at parsing, because a lot of presentation I have found that everybody is telling that parsing is two type, top down and bottom up. It is not true. Actually, parsing is a very complex topic. It is others type of technique, but that is not within the syllabus, so you cannot see. Parsing, the easiest one, and you have to learn it the top down, then the bottom up, and others. There are others also two kinds, top down and bottom up. Others means that it will not strictly left. It cannot start from left. It is not from right like Urdu, not from left. It can be dynamic type. So there are two algorithms, that is CYK algorithm. I have discussed little bit. It's a bottom up, and there's early parser which came up later. It is a top down. Both are very extremely good parser. This is called unambiguous grammar. Ambiguous grammar, they can parse it, and obviously ambiguous grammar to parse too. Okay. Now coming back to the parsing, where you have started your parsing journey with the top down with backtracking on, because top down is easy to visualize that you are starting from star symbol and you try to match your left hand terminal, because we know any rule cannot, because it's a context free grammar, is a type 2 rule, and type 2 rule, you know, the any variable cannot go vanish, only the start variable can do. Whenever you go to the upper rule like type 1 or type 0 grammar, there will see it in type 0 grammar, you see, remember, the right hand modulus, the length of the right hand side can be less than left hand side. So left hand side can be any string, right hand side any string, and the length may diminish, and that is very dangerous. That is very difficult to parse. So our top down parsing, what is assumption is, definitely we start with start symbol S or E, and we can definitely match from the left hand side, and we can. And even if the backtracking on, that is, you can parse any grammar. Definitely you can parse any grammar. That is called the brute force. And ambiguous, unambiguous, it can be parsed. But the problem will be, not only it can reach to O n cube, the major problem will be it will sometimes backtrack, maybe 10 step backward or 11 step backward. So it can be hanged. The problem is the program, actually computer program is always not good for backtracking, so it may hang. So that we forward. So we go, then next is top down LL1 deterministic, no background backtracking, but this is a good grammar. But only problem is there is no you cannot have no left recursive grammar. You have to remove the left, and left recursion also can be removed. Like we have this grammar, E is equal to E plus T forward slash T, T is equal to T star A forward slash F. And sometimes how to give importance to a particular symbol like star, in multiplication usually if you give the plus and star, we give more importance to star. So we must have another rule T like this. We can make another variable and T star F. If in some of your quiz you might see we want to give more importance to minus over than plus, then we can give T minus F. So that is a tricky thing, but this is expression grammar, but we have not taken full minus sign and divide by sign. If then the divide by also we have to take another variable like d to d, so divide by something f like this. So this is expression grammar in plus and star only, and we want to give importance by this root t is equal to t star f. So this grammar will work with the backtracking also, no issue, but there will be errors. And we have to change the grammar with some E dash. It is not the same E dash we have done for our LL0. It is, we have, so that no left recursion. So we have some rules. We change the rules. So looks a bit odd. So for programmers, we have to obey these rules, but it can be done. Top down LL1 is pretty good parsing techniques. Even some of the Python also can be done by LL1. Some modern languages also can be done by LL1 parsing. You can see the diagram here. LL1 is good enough. It can almost touch LR1. The inner, this one is LL1. and LR1 just a green one. So definitely it is better than LR0, but there are some common areas, so this is not proportional, but we can see in this diagram, this right hand side is the ambiguous grammar, so you cannot touch it, because you know the context free grammar is basically two distinct parts. One is deterministic context free grammar, which can be detected by deterministic Poisson automata, and context free grammar, non deterministic Poisson automata, and deterministic Poisson automata. That's a completely different grammar and machine, and it is computationally NP complete and all these things. But we take only this part. Even not all this part deterministic, you cannot have a grammar. So that is all tricky things. So that's it. So top down is good enough. Now the bottom up parsing. Bottom up parsing, we start with the shift reduced parsing. This is we start how to understand the parsing. This is in fact shift reduced parsing developed by 1965 by Donald Knuth. He's still here with us. So he's an extraordinary computer scientist. He has several volumes of books available in the library. He has all the sorting techniques, the complexity analysis, and the particularly text, a document processing language, LaTeX. All these contribution is there. He was one of the Turing Award winner, Donald Knuth. So he invented himself done this. Then the shift reduced grammar, then we'll go for this LR0. Here we can see, unlike any books, I make a two distinct column. One is LR0 item collection, one is LR1 item collection. The reason I am coming to it, LR0 item collection, we have experienced that, and LR0 parsing also, this is nothing different between LR0 parsing and shift reduce. They are almost same. In fact, they are same. Just only the canonical item collection is new. So with LR0, a little bit ahead than shift reduce. The LR0 definitely is a basic thing like LL1 parsing. Whenever LL1 parsing, we know how to calculate fast and follow. So same here, LR0 is the basic thing to understand. And then with this little modification that we just look ahead, in fact, LR0 computation, if you see whenever they were reducing the difference is in LR0, whenever you reduce it in all the state wise. Say in a state is one particular good, you go to rows, you book all state. But here in SLR or SLR1 or SLR, same is SLR2 cannot be, it will be definitely SLR1. But we generally see whenever reducing, we see the first calculate the fast and follow of all the variables. And whenever we are reducing, whether we see the next look ahead symbol is coming to the follow up that reducing variable. So that's it. SLR just only that case, it say R1, only that, not all the rows. So it is just a slight benefit, but it will give a lot of, if we look at only one terminal, one in your input, and whenever you are reducing, and you are, when you are reducing means left hand side must be variable, we must see, we have pre-computed fast and follow, we see follow up that variable, the next terminal should be a should be included there. If it is not, then it is definitely error, and go to error routine, and how to give error routine, then you have to from your stack, you know there is a stack, you can think of the stack contains state and the terminals are variable within it, or a two different stack, one is with the states and another is the terminals are variable, which is called semantic stack. So you pop the, if there is an error, you pop it until and unless you find a certain key terminus like semicolon or in the closing bracket of a paragraph. So whenever you are writing a C program, definitely semicolon means end of statement marker. Whenever a closing second bracket means a block of statement, you are finishing it. So we go till that. That means then all these things are garbage and go to the output that we are till parsing this, then the parsing again begins. This is, I'll go into the how to handle parsing, how to error processing, because there errors can be there, and there it will, this is fast and follow. In fact, follow give you much benefit to act, because in bottom-up parsing, you can at once detect the error whenever you see, when you're reducing by a reduce action and next terminal, it is not in the follow of that variable. The definitely the main. Then immediately you report it, okay? And before reporting it, and one thing can be, if one error comes, you just go out. This should not be. If one error comes out, then it's also report, and also it's try to flush it out, the your parser, the all the variable, even terminals and variables there, until and unless you find a semicolon or second bracket closing. That is a kind of a marker. It's a marker that till that it has been parsed. So then you continue to parsing, and any other error is, so whenever you see the GCC and you see this at once, it can detect two, three errors like this. Okay. Now coming back to the between the comparing between LR0 and SLR. LR0, whenever they are reducing, they don't look ahead, like Gandhari do not look ahead. In input terminal, SLR is just look ahead this one and see whether it will be coming. But then what is the LR1 we are looking this? LR1 is another advanced concept. LR1, every state is considered as per the, if the post in the, in the, in the, so every state we are drawing, we see the what could be the is after the very after this this variable, what are the terminals can be. So we the more number of states, and one beautiful thing is CLR1 and there is LLR1. Though the in various quiz question we found that LLR tables and SLR tables are same. Yes, correct, same. But they do not come from the LR0 connection. So they come from LR1 connection, and then from CLR1, we combine the entries of a table where the reducing rule is the same, even the reducing rule, say R2, and your after the what are the variables, after that will be the different, then we can combine the state. So remember, if your reducing rule is the same, and your CLR1, if the reducing rule can be same, but the your next terminals can be different, so they can be two different state. But LLR, they combine these two states, and then after combinations. Just a minute. LLR, what we're doing in CLR, where the even the reducing the follow of that are different, then those two states are combined in LLR. And whatever happens, the LLR table is the same as the SLR table. But remember, LLR is always derived from CLR, so it is a difficult to make. It is not easy, but it's total size is less than CLR. CLR is very difficult to make, but from you have to first make CLR1 table, then you have to make LLR. So construction will take time, but the size of the LLR table is the same as the SLR table, but they come from LR1 collection. So that is the logic. The bottom-up parsing we have both for LR0 item collection, LR0 very simple to understand. Then you just look ahead only one whenever you're reducing. So instead of R1 in all the rows, we fill up only that particular symbol, that is SLR. And if you go for LR1 type item collection, then we can combine certain states in LLR. And but one thing is there in CLR, there are very rare. See, there are two kinds of confusion, rather there is error slash. One is shift reduce and another is deduce reduce. Shift cannot be, that you can understand because it's unambiguous grammar. But this CLR grammar, both are all are clear almost, but you cannot say 100%. Generally no shift reduce or reduce reduce conflicts in CLR one. In look ahead, no shift reduce conflict cannot be extended. But reduce reduce error, which is tough, then you have to go for CLR. And SLR is the same, but here also it much functionality is less than this, but better than LRC. So LLR, comparing between LLR and CLR, that's a typical question comes. LLR size of the table is less. I am telling the example, like in C language there are some 100 grammar rules and 50 to 100 valid tokens. So there are several thousands of states. You take it very simple, 1,000 states, it may be more. And the entries, because states are there and there are the variables 50 or 100, there are minimum 100K entries are there. You can take it from 100 to 1,000K entries in the CLR1 table. This is the size of the table, though this can be reduced in LLR. But the thing is that it can in CLR1 hardly. But here, if you see the memory size for nowadays computer, this is nothing. So you can safely assume that LR1 can cater shift reduce problem, reduce reduce problem, all these things. This is I1 LLR reference. It's same, but in LLR, if reduce reduce conflicts, there may not be operation. If reduce reduce conflict, it can handle, it may not handle. CLR, it can handle. This is now we coming back to this. Now this is the end of. But you can ask whether the LR2. No, we stop LR1. Though in the diagram, if you see that LRK little bit more, it can happen more language. I particularly do not come across that LR2 or LR3. Always one look ahead, and there are other different parsing technique like CYK. It's one of the famous. It is a dynamic programming base, because you know it can try to get the common terminals together. It's a bottom up, and early parser is the top down. These are all generally n cube less than maybe 2.5 or something, but this is outside the syllabus. And here is the typical grammar. LL0 is no use at all. LR0 same, no use at all. SLR is a good amount of grammar. SLR1 is in it. LLR is definitely, a lot of languages are taking LLR, and LR1 is one of the best. So that one you can say green one, LR1 grammar. Yeah, this is one good diagram. I must tell it what is the hash portions are. This is the figure 4.31, very good from the Aho's book. This expression grammar, and you take another E dash to E. This is the why the shaded portion, the this is this white portion is called the kernel items, and this is the non-kernel items. What is the distinction between kernel items and non-kernel items? Because non-kernel items can be generated from the kernel items. So even if you omit it, it can be generated. Like E dash to dot E, because the dot E, so then all the rules can be, next rules can be generated from this. So here both are kernel items. Here this one is kernel items, because dot T, you can, all these things can be, all the shaded regions are called non-kernel. It can be from this rule you can. But one thing, this kind of diagram, you always check that whether the which can be the final state. It's like here you can see I3 dot at the end, and this is not the, this is the final state. I11 the final state. And another state is here I2. I2 say E T dot is the final state, and T dot star is, it is not final state. So this is typical confusion is whether to reduce or shift. So this is an ideal shift reduce config. Whenever you see in one particular state dot at the end, and state doesn't contain another unfinished accepted item, then it is shift reduce. So it cannot be done by LRC. You have to take LR1, this thing. Here also, this is totally unaccepted. Here I6, I9 is another state also. E is equal to E plus T dot is the accepted items, and T dot it is not. So it is again a shift reduce complex. So no, you don't have to go for your table creation. Before that, if you can draw your state diagram, it is very easy. You take the canonical items and then you go on doing this. And if you see the any particular states contains both final state and non-final state, then definitely it can be done by LR0. So one good thing is from LR0 you can draw it LR1. Then you have to add the next thing. We can see that. Yeah, this is what I am to say. This is kernel items. The initial item is the kernel, and non-kernel is general. This is important things. Yeah, this is also, you know very well, this is LR0 definitely SLR, this is clear. If there is no RR conflict in CLR1, then there may be a minimum. So that means LLR helpful. But CLR1 is canonical LR, that means LR1 is the best. That is also number of states, SLR, LLR are same, go to moves identical, sheet moves identical, deduce move may be different, else 0.1. So though SLR1 and LLR, your parsing table size are same, but LLR is much more better because reduce moves are much more accurate. So that is the reason LLR using all are using LR1 items, not LR. SLR using LR items. This 5 and 6 is very vital. Though LLR table are same with SLR, but confusion is LLR comes from the CLR1 table and SLR comes from LR0. Right now, for a typical language C, there are about 100 grammar rules and somewhere between 50 to 100 valid tokens. And LR1 parse table for such language has several thousand steps, several hundred. 1000 entries and a table size of order of 1 megabyte. That is not very big nowadays. Maybe 30 years back it was enough. Because C language has developed at Carnegie Mellon's time in 1961-62. LLR parsing table for the language has several hundreds and 20. So it is much smaller. It can solve all the problems that we see. LLR is most of the times they are using, even your Python and all this. They generally 4.453 of Ahu's book. The grammar LR1. This grammar is basically S to capital CC, C to small c capital C or D. So they have to just augment this grammar. That is augmented grammar is S to S. And before that, you must calculate all the first and fall. So S dash, there is no S dash do not come here, so definitely dollar. And S also do not come on the right hand side, so S also dollar. Follow S dash dollar. Now, yeah, and C, coming back to C. So because C is here, the first of C, what is the first of C? First of C is C or D. So here, C, follow of C is C, because C can also come here, C, D, dollar. First of A is C, 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 D, C also first of C, D. So, let's start this thing, right? This is I0, H dash to dot, and this is all of this is non-kernel items. I try to do shaded one, but Pahos book do not follow this, right? This first one is the kernel items. The S comes, so if in the this rule, the I only thought I found the house book, they put it the border like this, but precisely it should be border particular. Here, when the S comes, S dash to S dot, so this is the final item, and this is how to check it different than LR0, it's LR1, it's a comma dollar. So I will see the what is come after his death. So it's called a follow-up his death. So then comes the capital C, the C dot. These are all intermediate stage, and what is come after is C dollar. So here we all dictate not what is come after, it is not follow-up C. If the follow-up C, it will come CD dollar, which is the follow-up this dollar. We did this. But ultimately, whenever you see this grammar, if we after we draw this grammar, we do not find any rule which is in intermediate state. Yeah, this is final accepting, not accepting. This is fully accepting, which is the fully accepting. I make a concentric rectangle so that it is the accepting state. Like I1 is accepting state. I5 is accepting state, I9 is also, I7 is also, I8 is also, is also, yes, I4 is also. There is no state is there where mixture of this. So it can be done by LR0 automation. But why the question is why you have taken this, why AHO have taken this an LR0, but it is easier to draw the diagram. Like we have tried in E plus T diagram for LR0 automation. Just E, T, F, the diagram becoming more complex. So that is the reason probably, because it can be done by LR0 item collection and LR0 grammar can parse this. But why you have taken for LR1? Just to give an example, because there is no conflict between shift reduce. It is everywhere reduce is final, all this state. So, but only thing is you first calculate fast and follow, and there is no harm to it also. It is not much complex than LR0 to LR1. In fact, the states will be the same. It is not mandatory the LR1 states will be larger than LR0. Here we can see that LR0 and LR1 grammar can be the same. Okay. But only reduce rule, we are not copied it to all states. That is the difference. The rules will be different. The reduce rule, and remember all the vacant rules means it will give error. Basically, this is a switch case statement in your parser. This parser is nothing but a switch case, and whenever any in vacant position, we can put our error routine so that we can flush out in which case you can flush out your parse or follow, and then we can so that debugging of the program can be not only any compile time error can be getting. So this is definitely different from LR0 grammar. LR0 grammar all will be the accepted state. Stage 5, all will be R1 like this. So it is a mistake. So, what we have come, how to calculate the LR1? This is it. We always take the follow. See here, see what is the follow of C, CD. You can always ask why it is not C slash dollar. That is your, and here it will come from I0. So, definitely the LR0 parsing table and LR1 parsing table, this LR1 is different. Various ways is different. Accept only at one. Reduced rule will be that quarter. And state numbers also will be the less. In LR0, definitely we have a duplicate state here. As for LR0, that will be duplicate. That is I3 and I6. They will be combined in LR0 and SLR also. So definitely this one is a better grammar. Parsing will be quicker, error handling will be better. This is you can get it AHO's figure 4.53. This is an example of the LR1 grammar. This is this one I must tell that we have already parsing is already done. Say we have chosen the LR1 grammar or LLR, definitely LLR. We now prove that SLR cannot be a grammar of choice, or LR0 or LL1 cannot be grammar of choice if any good programming language. So definitely it should be LLR or LR1. That is, it is proven. That is, it is proven. So here, what is the output of this parser? That is, output should be not like our machine that whenever we go for this PDA machine, accept or not accept, no, definitely it should accept, yes, but alongside it should give a parsing tree. Again and again, it will now the parsing tree, it be different whatever you know at your automata course to detect whether ambiguous or unambiguous. Here the output will be semantic. Semantic tree is a subset of parsing tree. The semantic tree is nothing but your node position will be a always some operation, and leaf position all your variable terminals or your operand sort of thing. And this is all other where is plus minus and all this node. This is called the semantic. Semantic tree, all the parser LLR and LR1, after accepting it, it will output a semantic tree. And the semantic tree, it is always a bottom-up approach. Value of this, or value at the node position will be determined by the child. So that is called a particular name. So it will be like synthetic attribute. Okay? It will be made from its child. That is, and another is L attribute. We'll come to this, which comes from parent or siblings. The two kinds of attributes, because ultimately after your syntax analysis, you got your, if it's error free, you should get your this thing. Excuse me. Extremely sorry. What is your, after parsing, if successful parsing, so you will get output will be the parse tree, and all the nodes of the parse tree will come from the bottom up, like it is a synthetic. But whenever you are declaring in a programming language, particularly static declaration like C or Java, whenever you declare that int i1 comma i2 initialize i3 equal to 10, semicolon, then that is not synthetic. That is a L attribute. You are giving attribute at the beginning. That is not a context-free grammar. So our programming, I have always told, it is not 100% context-free grammar. Any declaration, it is not a context-free grammar. Any declaration, it is a L attribute. That is, you are getting attribute from top-down approach, and what is a synthetic attribute? Where this attribute is coming from bottom-up approach. So your semantic analysis will check it, whether your integer is coming to float is coming to integer, string is coming to integer. If it is, whether you have a typical casting operation is done or not, what would be the target. So all these meanings of the variables or the nodes, coercion, you can say coercion, which is called you are fixing a big floating point number, you truncate it to an integer, or integer to floating point number, it coercion. This kind of analysis, whether correct or not, as per programmatically, it cannot be done by syntax analysis. No bottom up parsing can detect it. It is the role of our semantic analysis check after the syntax analysis. And here, whenever they are doing it, they also start intermediate code generation. And intermediate code generation, I have covered the last three address code. So if you have a multiple operation in a expression, they put it in a, or like it is a single operation at a time, and it will break up a big expression in multiple expression, and only three address, destination and source one and source two. It is very easy to implement by three register one into plus register one goes to register three, any operation, three address code, then this kind of optimization will help to intermediate code. Then ultimate machine code, whenever it will be run on that particular machine, it will be machine code. But all these things, semantic analysis check and the intermediate code generation is done, and this semantic phase. And there are lots of problems are there, but we'll check. So this is the example. This is the intermediate code generation I have covered last class. This is it, because you know the nowadays intermediate code can be for virtual machines like Java, like in Android, Python. The three address code, there's a typical question comes in the in any the lot of questions will come there, easy questions. Role of closer to target language, machine independent, that is always helping machine independence, because you don't go to the machine before machine. See, if you are in a working in a loop, we try to minimize if loop, maybe any loop particularly maybe 100 or 1000 times. So if we simplify that loop, certain things to be taken out of the loop, so that will be implemented once and twice, a lot of saving is there. I have told last class, like while checking, say while I less than an expression, big expression, while I less than big expression, it will do. So every time if you put the same code in your target code, then every time the big expression will be calculated. So what will you do, you know, while I less than big expression, we make the big expression before this step, we calculate and say we put it at j, then we put while I less than j. So we are not doing that big expression repeatedly by the loop. That is a loop optimization. That is called code motion. We take certain code to the outside of the loop. That is code motion. That will help. So code should, it will be, we should target that our code should not be in a big loop. So that is a code motion, a typical thing. What is this grammar, this particular grammar? This I give an example for our LR0 automation. It is easier to understand. Because how do you know this LR1? You see, all our rules are repeated. You can check this rules and operation. The question is, the grammar is both LR1 and LR0. I gave it a correct one.